Hey everyone, Gaijin Goomba here. Well, with the last video doing absolutely gangbusters and my announced homebrew D&D race of the Tanuki hitting Electrum status on DM's Guild, I finally sat down on the 12th and started my long-needed week off. But, fate did not smile brightly on me that day. The week was fraught with some of the worst allergies I'd ever had, and I kept getting dragged back into work, so needless to say, I didn't get much of a chance to unwind. Well, except for that weekend stream. Seriously, you guys are crazy. So by Friday, I just said screw it, I need to relax, and ended up sitting down with one of my favorite feel-good movies of all time, Spirited Away. A 2001 Studio Ghibli film that won like a bazillion awards. And why wouldn't it? Its music, its story, its pacing, its visuals, oh god, its visuals. It all culminates into a timeless story, a tale you would tell your kids before tucking them into bed. But as I sat there watching, I realized something. For being my quote favorite movie of all time, I have not once ever done a cultural analysis piece on it in nearly the 10 years of doing YouTube. And trust me, there's a ton to talk about in this movie. I suppose at least part of that has to do with Studio Ghibli's zero tolerance policy on copyright, but I'm at a point where my supporters are the ones who, well, support me. And as long as this particular video is publicly accessible, that's all I really care about. So with all that said, I'm gonna give Little G a break until next upload and finally do what I've been wanting to do for a very, very long time. Personally break down the cultural and folklore inspirations behind the movie that has kept my childlike, joyous wonder alive for Japan for the better part of 20 years. Because everything in this film, from its characters to its concepts to much of its design and music, stems from Studio Ghibli's domestic folklore. I mean, don't get me wrong, there are a lot of overarching themes that transcend culture in this movie. Spirited Away spends a great deal of time talking about the themes of growing up, environmental awareness, and surprisingly, every single character in this movie has their own unique development arc in dealing with greed. In fact, I could do an entire separate video explaining how each narrative beat in this movie is dealing with the temptation of and repercussions of greed, but that's not what this video is about. Today, we're talking about the sheer level of extensive inspiration this movie takes from Shinto and other Japanese folklore. And I know that's not exactly the most radical thing that's been said about this movie. I mean, for crying out loud, take one look at the box art and you know exactly what kind of world you're getting into. But there's way more than meets the eye when it comes to the world that the viewer is thrusted into. The least of which comes from the very title of the movie. Not Spirited Away, but its original Japanese name, Sento Chihiro no Kamikakushi. Which I suppose you could loosely translate as Sen and Chihiro's spiriting away. Now, every culture has its own stories of humans being whisked away into another world and having to essentially deal with it. And now more than ever, the concept of isekai or otherworld anime in the Western anime community is nearly as homogenous a term as waifus and weeaboos. But this one word, kamikakushi, is something very, very specific. Literally meaning hidden by God, kami, spirit, etc., I've never been able to find out exactly where this concept got started in Japan, but it was popularized during the yokai boom of the Edo period, but sorry, I digress. In every example of kamikakushi, from my known examples in Takayama and Gifu prefecture, all the way to Kanazawa City and Ishikawa prefecture, it's always a young human being taken away into the spirit world specifically by one or more kami, a Shinto deity representative of a beneficial aspect of nature, or a yokai, a Shinto deity representative of a detrimental aspect of nature. Which, verbatim, is what happens to Chihiro. In fact, the movie even subtly follows the old Japanese belief that the periods between night and day is when the mundane and spiritual world cross into each other. During the Heian period, it was widely believed that the twilight brought with it the Hyakkyagyo, or procession of 100 demons, with anyone caught up in it basically being a goner. And that one scene on the bridge, when Chihiro found Haku but before the spirits really began to appear, yeah, it's twilight. I'll bet it's twilight for like 5 seconds, which is weird, but still, it's a small little detail but a poignant pointing to Japan's old folklore about the spirit world. Now, I know that seems incredibly basic, like whatever, it's Japan's fairy tale world, but when looking at the characters of the movie, it's almost uncanny at just how finely detailed Studio Ghibli took inspiration from kami, yokai, and everything Shinto. Not only in the physical design of these characters, but also how they behave and their roles in the story. Like, let's take Kamachi for example. The quite literally old boiler man who heats the baths and preps the waters of Yubaba's luxury sento. He's not exactly a super important character on the surface. In fact, I think out of all of the named characters, he gets the least amount of screen time. But he acts as a narrative catalyst in several important meetings throughout this movie. He's the in-between with Chihiro meeting Nin and subsequently Yubaba herself, the in-between of Chihiro going off to see Yubaba's twin sister Zeniba, and finally it's he who, off-screen, tells Haku where to find Chihiro, which led to one of the biggest climaxes in the movie. But all that aside, we still have to ask, in terms of folklore, what kami or yokai does Kamachi take after? And from what I saw buzzing around the internet, a lot of people tend to attribute him to the Tsuchigumo, or Earth Spider, a magical sentient arachnid that takes the form of a human, a spider, or a hybrid of both. And there's a lot of folk stories involving these guys, many of which have the Tsuchigumo looking to usurp and manipulate powerful leaders, with the most famous tale being Tsuchigumo Soshi back in the 1500s, which told the story of a spider lad who tried to take out folklore legend Minamoto no Yorimitsu. But does that really sound like the Kamachi that we know and love? Yeah, not really, does it? I mean, sure, the dude's got six pairs of arms, a pair of legs, and that weird sort of hunch on his back that absolutely gives him a spidery appearance, though I've never heard of a Tsuchigumo that had Mr. Fantastic stretchy arms. But evil and manipulative? Absolutely not Kamachi. If anything, he's one of the most giving, self-sacrificing characters in the movie. So then, is all this just coincidental? Actually, no. Because it turns out that not all spiders get a bad rap in Japan. In fact, they have a very interesting saying, quote, "Let spiders live in the morning, kill spiders at night." A generic superstition in Japan that a spider in the morning brings luck, while one in the evening brings evil. But that superstition actually stems from something that perfectly fits Kamachi's character and role. In the Nihon Shoki, there's an interesting passage dated back to 400 AD, a poem written by one Sotori Irasume, wife of the emperor who waited in Fujiwara for him to visit. Waga seko ga kubeki yoi nari, sasagane no kumo no okonai, koyoi shurushimo. This is the night my husband will come, the little crab, the spider's action. Tonight is manifest. Scholars notated that since the popularization of this ancient poem, it was believed that when a spider clung to one's clothing, it was a sign that an intimate friend would arrive. And doesn't that just sound like the spidery old man we know? Like I said, Kamachi is responsible for the meeting and reuniting of all of Chihiro's dearest friends. Nin, Haku, Zeniba, even Yubaba to an extent. He was the catalyst of all the main characters' important meetings. Coincidence? Maybe, but we're just getting started with the characters. I mean, good grief, do you see how long this video is? So how about the greatest of Chihiro's friends, Haku? Or should I say, Niki Hayamiko Akunushi? God, Kami got long names. Anyway, Haku's character and his arc represents one of the most important yet basic principles of Shinto that I think a lot of people have overlooked. Haku's dilemma in the movie is that he can't remember his real name, because Yubaba took it like all of her other workers, nor could he find his home. From what we understand, it's just gone and he's lost. Then at the end of the movie, we learn that Haku originally was the spirit of a river. The problem, it turns out, is that the river was filled in with concrete and paved over for an apartment complex. So let's get one thing out of the way here. I know there's supposed to be this sort of mysticism with the idea that Haku is actually a long, snaky lung dragon, but really, just about every single kami and spirit I've ever seen in Shinto is a dragon. Heck, back in my old hometown in Mie, the water kami that was believed to dwell in a nearby mountain river was a dragon. So why are they always dragons? Well, it's pretty simple, really. See this? And this? Yeah, it's actually pretty simple, right? But this insight provides two very important observations. Haku is a kami, not just a plain dragon, and Haku, as a kami, is a physical manifestation of an aspect of nature. In this case, a river. And when it comes to Shinto kami, well, they dwell in very specific objects. For example, if you were ever to go into any Shinto shrine, you have a building with an offering box where people pray, but then another building right behind it that's completely closed off to the public. Within that building resides a very special item that houses the spirit of the kami, called a yoshiro. Other times, though, kami reside in the yoshiro object that they themselves represent. These can be rocks, trees, even mountains and rivers that will typically be roped off with shimenao and shide. But here's the thing. The state of the existence for a kami is directly tied to the yoshiro that they dwell in. For example, if a tree that housed the kami was cut down, one of two things could possibly happen based on what I've researched. Either A, the kami is cut off from the human world and is either banished or ceases to be, much in the way that Haku is unable to find his objective home, or B, the kami turns into a yokai and starts cursing people or causing natural disasters. And that takes us right to our next symbolic characterization of traditional Shinto, the stink spirit slash river spirit. The appearance and subsequent transformation of this nameless kami actually embodies one of the most essential and core concepts of Shinto. But before I start rattling your brains with more esoteric terms, let me give you guys some grounding. So out of the rain, headed to the bathhouse, is this sentient amalgamation of filth and grime, literally oozing sludge with a distinct odor that could be sent seemingly a mile away. Not stopping for anyone, the creature of living filth pays its fee and heads over for a bath, much to everyone's dismay. But upon closer inspection of the creature, it's discovered that there's junk poking from its body. And with a few heave-hoes, a torrent of trash, filth, and other general crap is yanked from the body of the spirit, who turns out to be an elderly river kami, similar to Haku, wearing a no-okina mask representing the spirit's age and wisdom. But this river spirit is way bigger, way more powerful, and way richer than Haku. So this seems like a really simple concept. You got a river spirit that got all junked up with trash and is just trying to find a way to clean up, right? Well, it's actually a bit more than that. Because what this narrative beat represents is the fluidity, at least in my analysis anyway, between kami and yokai. As I said way earlier on in this video, kami represent the useful aspects of nature to humanity. Everything from tangible things like clean, calm rivers, good weather, and well-grown plants, to concepts that can be boiled down to luck, for lack of a better way to put it. Yokai, on the other hand, represent the negative aspects of the natural world. Disease, drought, flooding, annoying little noises that keep you up at night, these are all caused by yokai. But yokai and kami are not isolated entities. In fact, more often than not, the two have a tendency to transform back and forth into each other. With the best case I could think of being Sugawara no Michizane. He was a scholar turned exile after the court unfairly judged him, and upon his death turned into a vengeful onryo spirit, causing natural disasters all over Kyoto. But eventually, the emperor himself enshrined Sugawara as a kami and thus became Tenjin-sama, kami of learning, quelling the disasters that befell the capital. Now, going back to Spirited Away, the river spirit didn't roll into the Sento as a really grody dragon that needed a bath, was it? No, it was an entirely different entity, a tentacled blob of filth and muck created from the pollution of its object of residence, a river. Then, when it was finally purified, it emerged in an entirely different form to that of a water dragon wearing the mask of an old man. This creature rolled into Yubaba's bathhouse as a yokai of filth and foul smells, things that do happen in the polluted natural world, and left as a kami of clean water, a positive attributed aspect of nature, and left behind to Chihiro, a medicinal dango. This feeds into another ongoing theme that this movie houses that I'm sure skirted by without a lot of people outside of Japan noticing, the Shinto concepts of kegare and harae, uncleanliness and purity. I mean that in a fairly literal sense too. See, unlike Judeo-Christian focuses on morality, Shinto breaks down its positive and negative aspects of the spirit to that which is clean and new versus that which is dirty and old. And in Spirited Away, there's a lot of examples of the Shinto-rooted concept, not the least of which being the transformation from yokai to kami with the river spirit. But there's also the grimy slug ejected from Haku, Kaonashi's literal purging of filth and inevitable selfish greed, both of which were flushed out by using the medicinal dango given by the river spirit, by the way. And finally, it seems like everyone's freaking out over blood. All this filth and negativity associated with it is deeply rooted in the concept of kegare. Kegare is something of an aura of defilement that's built up from exposure to that which Shinto deems unclean, of which death, disease, and blood are the top conduits for kegare. Actions of immorality such as crime can create kegare, but it can also be accumulated by things outside of human control, such as a death in the community or a family member recovering from a disease. Therefore, it's not really a morally driven concept, but regardless of how it's created, it has to be purged lest it continue to fester and grow, not only plaguing one's home with disease and unluck, but inevitably spreading to the entire community. To curb kegare, typically one of two rituals is done to remove it, harare and misogi. Harare is a generalized ritual of evoking some of the more major kami to cleanse the body, mind, and even locations and objects, and then waving a gohei in the vicinity. Salt is also sometimes sprinkled as an additional act of purification. Then there's misogi, which has its own process of preparation, including prayer, more salt sprinkling, and sometimes sake spitting. But it more or less boils down into a sort of ritualistic bathing in a natural pool, or more often than not, a waterfall. Which, yeah, that kinda smacks of the Grand River Spirit's purification from a stinky yokai to a clean kami, bathing in a pool with a cascade of water running down it. But while that might just be a huge coincidence, there are definite one-on-one connections in Spirited Away that harken back to Shinto-rooted cleanliness. When Chihiro makes short work of Yubaba's black slug, Kamachi beckons her over quickly. Of course, if you're reading this with subtitles or watching the movie in English, the following actions of Chihiro making a ring and Kamachi breaking it makes no freaking sense. But listen to it purely in Japanese, and you can hear Kamachi saying a very specific phrase.
Engacho, say engacho.
Now, engacho is more of a kid's thing to be certain, but should said kid find themselves touching something super grody, they'll either form a circle with their hands with their index fingers and thumbs touching, or create a line with both index fingers touching, while a friend cuts it with their hand. With this action, the filth of the ick that the kid touched is gone. Yeah, I know, far from a traditional Shinto rite, but a rite steeped in the concept of kegare nonetheless. I mean, look at kids over in the States. We wall around the dirt all day and we don't give a good gosh dang. Finally, the last example of this kegare crap comes from Spirited Away's apparent hemophobia. Twice do people freak out over Chihiro having blood on her hands. First with a regular frog worker, and then with Bo, Yubaba's titanic baby boy. And what did we say were the three huge sources of kegare? Death, disease, and blood. You know, speaking of Bo, there's actually a huge theory surrounding the folkloric origins of him and Big Mama Yubaba. Now, what do we know about the two? Yubaba is a rich, greedy, and supremely powerful witch with a temper like a demon. Bo, on the other hand, is a giant naked baby, save for his red apron, and unprecedented strength to match his size, despite struggling to stand on his own two feet. Now, there's way too close a parallel to another roided-out child of folklore, Kintaro and his mountain hag of a mother. Kintaro, later known in life as the hero Sakata no Kintoki, started off as a crimson-red baby with physical strength that could rival the Hulk, oftentimes being depicted as wrestling a giant carp about twice its size and other different kinds of dangerous animals. But other stories say that he could smash rocks into pebbles and uproot trees like it was nothing. And above all else, Kintaro was known for being naked save for his trademark apron with the kanji for gold on the front. Yeah, that pretty much sums up Bo to a T. But then there's Kintaro's mother and her connection to Yubaba. Baby Crimson Hulk's mom, known as Yaegiri, was actually a wealthy as heck princess in the village of Jizoldo near Mount Ashigara. In one version of the tale, Yaegiri abandons Kintaro in the mountains where he's picked up and raised by Yamauba, basically a magical mountain hag. And in the other, Yaegiri was forced into exile from infighting between her husband and other samurai, eventually taking on the monkier of a Yamauba. So, yeah, in both cases, we have a super rich magical hag that raises her titanic son as a single mother. Not sure how we could call this one huge coincidence. You know what? Speaking of all these folklore characters, let me just go back to the idea of yokai and kami in this movie and just plow through each one I can find. First off, at the very beginning of the movie, a lot of kami and Shinto lack a proper anthropomorphic form, so that might explain all the blobby black spirits going on here. But before that, we've got the Dosoujin. Now, rather than a specific deity, these are smaller shrines and statues devoted to a plethora of smaller or travel-oriented kami, and surprisingly, a lot of these roadside kami have an emphasis on fertility and matrimony. But there are a good number of them like Jizo who do act as protectors of travelers. Next, coming off a luxury liner, we've got Kasuga-sama spirits, kami native to Grand Kasuga Taisha Shrine in Kyoto, where performers enact the traditional Ama ritual dance wearing paper masks called Zomen, which are pretty much identical to what we see the spirits wearing in the movie, alongside their Sokotai court garments from the Heian period. Moving along, we see a lot of these long-horned, long-fanged creatures wearing what looks like a straw coat and one's carrying around a cleaver? Nah, don't worry, this is actually pretty standard for the great Akita Oni known as Namahage. On New Year's Eve, a few folks living in the Oga Peninsula in Akita Prefecture will dress up in big horned oni masks and large Mino straw coats, carrying around Deba knives and Teoke buckets, going house to house scaring the bejesus out of little children, saying, "Wariko wa inai ka?" Or, "Are there any bad kids around?" Kinda like an army of Krampuses, but you can get them to go away by giving them mochi. So, yeah, dark colored, horned, straw coat wearing yokai wielding knives. Seems about right. Then there's Oshira-sama, the chubby, lovable daikon spirit. Now, his origins come not quite from Japan's ultra-thick radishes, but rather pairs of mulberry wood dolls that were seen as representatives of protective deities of Sera culture dressed up in tiny clothes. Apparently, it was also believed that rubbing parts of the body of the doll was said to relieve pain in one's own body in the same location. Yeah, not exactly a solid one-to-one connection, but it is still a reference. Finally, as far as yokai go, we've got Yubaba's bouncing henchmen heads, Kashira. But let's be real here. These three are verbatim Tsurube Otoshi. And with a name that literally means well bucket drop, you could probably guess what these guys are all about. Tsurube Otoshi were little more than gigantic heads that liked hanging out in trees that would leap out and crush passersby, consuming what remains or just do it for fun, then returning to the tree line, guffawing and taunting as they go. Now, while most of the time they're solitary predators, apparently in the Tohoku area, they're more smaller headed and work in groups, similar to what we see in the movie, just with less head-crushing and more illusionary transformation. Okay, I've been pattering on for almost 20 minutes now, so let me wrap up with two quick final Shinto concepts. Towards the latter half of the movie, we see Haku in dragon form being mauled by a flock of flying paper humanoids. This is basically Japanese shorthand for Shikigami, essentially smaller yokai or oni that Omyoji court wizards were believed to summon and indenture to their whims. Though in the past, some say these folded humanoid papers were used as a conduit for summoning said yokai, but these days it seems like the paper itself just comes to life and does the bidding of the caster who summoned it. Finally, I have got to talk about Yubaba's contract magic of stealing people's true names. In the movie, this is essentially how she gets control of and dominate people, taking pieces of their names. This comes from the extremely old Shinto concept of Kotodama, or soul in the word. In ancient Japan, words and names held a mysterious power just as all aspects of natural existence did. Native Japanese words and phrases were said to have a power all their own if uttered under a pure motive, but the names of kamis also had their own unique power. If you ever pick up an Omamori charm from a Shinto shrine, you'll find the name of the shrine or the deity that houses it written on the charm. And within that name is believed to reside the residence and power of said kami, giving the name alone an ethereal power. I could honestly go on and on with this movie. The dozens of Tsukumogami yokai that appear in this film, the beautifully melancholy train scene in Miyazaki's explanation of artistically using empty space called ma, and I know for a fact that a lot of you folks would love to hear my take on Spirited Away's connection to Yuna Bathhouse Girls, the concept of taking prostitutional names called Genjina, and the implications that there may be some illicit activities going on in Yubaba Sento, but there's plenty of other videos and articles on that. I want to focus on what personally made me love this movie, both as a teenager and as an adult. The insane depth Spirited Away goes in with its homegrown culture. Countless kami, yokai, and Shinto principles that not only put me in awe as a kid, but gave me a much greater love and respect for Japan as an adult. And I hope after watching this, you might find a greater appreciation for where this gem comes from and the culture it represents too. But whether you loved it or hated it, thanks for watching everyone, and a super big thank you to my patrons who keep videos like this alive. Again, I do apologize to all you over on Patreon. Had I known how deep this rabbit hole went, I would have scheduled things a little bit better. But nevertheless, I'm super glad I was able to put it together. And if you love the idea of learning more about Japanese culture from your favorite games, anime, and movies, sub up, get notified, and check in every week or so because we are always uploading. Or head on over to twitch.tv/gaijinkumba where we break down culture live. But either way, everyone, until next time, this is Gaijin Goomba, signing out.